if we're going to work with Bayes' theorem, or even talk intelligently about Bayes' theorem, we need to understand something called the prior probability, or sometimes we just call it the prior for short. When you're using Bayes' theorem, what you're doing is adjusting your level of belief or updating the likelihood that you would assign to some hypothesis based on new evidence that's coming in. Now, what's being adjusted or updated? Well, it's the prior probability. It's the initial probability that you would assign to something if you didn't have that evidence. Here's how it works. When you say that you would assign a certain likelihood to something, what you're actually saying is that, given all the possible universes that could exist, I think this many universes contain this as a truth. If I have positive or confirming evidence coming in for my hypothesis, then if I was pretty sure of myself, it gets even bigger. But if I wasn't very sure of myself, it still gets bigger. It just doesn't finish up as big. You might ask, how do these priors get set? Well, we set them based on our experiences up to the point where we get the new evidence. That's why two people can be looking at the exact same evidence and still disagree about something. Let's do another one of those thought experiments. Let's say that I'm a believer in astrology. In fact, I'm such a believer that I organize my whole life around astrology. And let's say that you're a skeptic. You believe that astrology is some superstition from the Middle Ages and not worth anything. Well, what if I'm going to try to convince you that astrology is worthwhile? What if I bring you some remarkable evidence? Let's say I came to you with this morning's newspaper, and it has my horoscope, and the horoscope says that your financial troubles are over. Then I tell you that I got this phone call out of the blue, and I was offered this fantastic job. Now, let's say that you trust me completely, and that both of us are looking at the same evidence, and we both agree that this is truly remarkable. This evidence would be very unusual if we lived in a universe where astrology was not a working mechanism. Let's look at what this does to the P's. Now, I believe big time in astrology. So the relative number of universes where I think astrology is a real working force is large. Then we get this truly unexpected evidence, my unusual offer of a lucrative job. Well, when we do our Bayesian updating for this new evidence, I get a minor increase in my level of certainty that astrology is real. That's because my level of belief was pretty large to begin with. But this new evidence does increase my confidence. Now let's take a look at your plate. You're the skeptic. You have very little trust in astrology. You would predict that relatively very few possible universes could contain the truth that astrology actually works. In most of the universes that you believe to be possible, you believe people are deluding themselves or focusing on coincidences. But both you and I agree on the evidence. It's very surprising. So it's a small red evidence circle. When we do our Bayesian updating based on the evidence, your confidence in astrology gets a big boost. It may double or even triple in size. But your confidence in astrology started out so small that you still believe it's a pile of hooey. You would have to see a whole lot more remarkable confirmations like the one we just had before you're going to believe in astrology. Now, you might be thinking this whole thing is pretty subjective. If you can come up with whatever answer you want, based on your prior beliefs. Now, I have two important points to make about this. Number one, Bayes' theorem is as good as you can do. Bayes' theorem shows us mathematically that this is as good as it gets. You can't do any better based on limited data. It would be great to have a whole lot of data. If I was a manufacturer of a drug that was supposed to cure migraines, I could collect a whole lot of data. I could hire 5,000 volunteers to test the drug and carefully record how many were cured and how many got no results. And I could use a different type of statistical analysis. I could use what they call frequentist statistics to analyze how well this drug works, and I could be pretty confident in my answer. But unfortunately, life doesn't work that way for the day-to-day things we deal with. We don't have that much evidence. And so Bayes' theorem is as good as you can do. But it's not all that bad. If you even have a fair amount of evidence, something else can take place. And this is point number two. Something happens called washing out the priors. What happens is the priors become less and less important if you can collect a couple pieces of evidence. Here's how it works. Let's look at the P's. Let's say I have a certain level of confidence in some hypothesis. And then let's say positive evidence comes in. Well, I gain more confidence in that hypothesis. And then what if more positive evidence comes in? I'm even more confident. And then yet again more positive evidence comes in. Well, I finish up with a pretty high level of confidence in that hypothesis. Now, what if some person had an inappropriately small amount of confidence in that hypothesis? Well, let's say he gets the same positive evidence. The first time this evidence comes in, it increases his confidence. Then again, and eventually, looking at the same evidence that I'm looking at, we will begin to come to similar conclusions and trust that hypothesis. So two people should come to the correct answer if they gain enough evidence and if they look at the evidence honestly. That's why people with experience seem to know what they're doing and they get really good results. Let's say I was going to lay a brick patio. Now, I don't know anything about brick patios, so the first thing I'd do is I'd go talk to an expert, someone who's done a lot of brick patios, and I'd expect all the advice he gives me to be 100% on the money. The reason is because he's made a lot of mistakes and he's had a lot of successes over a long period of time, and this has caused him to wash out his priors. No matter what nutty ideas this person had, eventually he will have figured that out, and all of the ideas that he now has should be pretty good ideas, and I want to know about that. That's called washing out the priors. Now, there's a way to foil this whole system, and that is, if you're absolutely certain about something, if you're 100% sure about something, then the process of washing out the priors falls apart. Now, we all are probably very sure about certain things. You're probably pretty certain that if you hold a brick out in front of you and let go of it, that gravity is going to pull it to the ground. And you're probably very sure that your mother loves you, or that you might be sitting at a computer right now. Interestingly, science is never 100% sure of anything. And there's a good reason for that. If you go back and look over the history of science, it's littered with theories that we were so confident about, and it turns out that they failed, and there's a better theory that replaces them. But that's a different subject. Now, here's what you're saying. When you say that you're 100% confident of something, you're saying that this proposition that you're so confident in exists in every universe on the plate. Now, this might work great for our ideas about things like gravity, where we're not likely to get contrary evidence. But for other things, it might mean that we'll have to deflect evidence, or that we'll have to modify our auxiliary hypotheses in order to keep our cherished hypothesis alive. Let's say I have some crazy idea. Let's say I believe that Episcopalians are terrible drivers. Well, what I'm actually saying is, the idea that Episcopalians are bad drivers is actually a truth in every possible universe on my entire plate. Now, let's say you're a more rational person, and you're going to try to talk some sense into me. You might point out that, hey, Sally down the street, she goes to the Episcopalian church, and she's a good driver. Well, I might counter that one by saying, look, I've talked to Sally. She doesn't agree with the religious beliefs of the people who go to that church, so she's not really an Episcopalian. You might say, okay then, how about these insurance statistics? They don't show that Episcopalians are any worse drivers than anybody else. I might say, well, of course they don't. That would be so politically incorrect. The insurance company is going to cover that one up. At this point, you might get pretty frustrated with me. You might say, well, what if Jehovah himself appeared right in front of you and said, look, Episcopalians are fine people. They're good drivers. Stop criticizing them. I could even counter that one by saying, I don't believe that was really Jehovah. I believe that was some evil spirit that's come to deceive me. Well, at this point, you might be pretty exasperated. You might say, okay, is there anything that could convince you otherwise? Well, that's a very good question to ask. When you have to get to the point of asking me that question, and if I can't say that there's any evidence that would convince me otherwise, that means this conversation isn't going to go anywhere. It means that the hypothesis occupies every pea on my plate, and all the evidence has to fit inside that hypothesis. No matter how many times I do my Bayesian updating, my set of universes never contain anything other than universes where I believe that Episcopalians are terrible drivers. A person who's totally certain will never be convinced otherwise. If you're 100% sure of something, your priors will never wash out. The same is true if you're 100% doubtful. If you're totally convinced that some hypothesis is false, that hypothesis doesn't exist in any universe on your plate. Your prior is zero. No matter how much updating takes place, that hypothesis will never become one of your beliefs. Bayes' theorem shows us where our differences lie. If you get to the point where someone's absolutely certain about something, then it's not about the evidence anymore. You may want to discuss with that person how reasonable they're being. In fact, there's some types of psychoses that are characterized by an absolute belief in something in the face of contrary evidence. If I was 100% sure that I had a brain tumor, despite 3 neurologists and 4 MRIs that said otherwise, then I've probably lost my grip with reality. Being totally certain of something allows us to keep our belief, but we never gain new knowledge. Now please, tune into the next couple videos. There's a lot more interesting ideas that fall right out of Bayes' theorem.